In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This Sunday, Malachi the prophet is the voice crying out for us. And it's fitting for penultimate Sunday, the next to the last Sunday of the church year, for the next to the last voice of the Old Testament to be the one we hear, the last of what we consider the Old Testament prophets. But we have to always remember that John the Baptizer is really the last of the Old Testament prophets. The last who will actually see the face of his Messiah before his own death, a death like all of the prophets. This particular text, this Malachi chapter 4, is also assigned to Populus Zion, the second Sunday of Advent in the historic one-year lectionary. And there it's coupled with Psalm 80, whose antiphon is the source of the day's name. And it goes like this. Restore us, O God, let your face shine that we may be saved. A better translation, although in worser English, might sound something like, repent us, O God. Turn us from our wickedness. Give us repentance. Bring us into this state of being that is oppositional to our sinful selves. And do it as you always have for your people of old and your people today. By your gifts, Lord, save us from ourselves. Save us for yourself. And so, with that as a pivot point before and after, hear the words of Malachi chapter 4. For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all arrogant and evildoers will be stubble. The day that is coming shall set them ablaze, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. The end of the church year points to the end of days, to the end of the world, to the final judgment of all mankind. It points us to the second advent, the new heavens and the new earth, repentance, restoration, resurrection, and salvation. Finally and fully delivered in body and soul to the people of God. And the end of the church here also swings us right back to the first advent, the end of days, salvation, the incarnation, salvation in the midst of the earth, delivered for the first time. The character of the second and first advent differ from that of Lent. Lent is a character of something that is always lurching ever towards Good Friday and Easter in penitence and preparation. And Advent is also preparation, as is the end of the church year. Preparation for Christmas. That's the obvious thing. But preparing us for the day of the Lord as well. The day of the Lord is coming soon. It's right around the corner. And all arrogant and all evildoers, you know, those people over there, those sinful ones, not us. We're wise, we're righteous, we're wise virgins, we're righteous sheep type people. We're ever vigilant, we're never sleepy. We would never look to our own works to justify our salvation. We would never tolerate institutionalized covetousness. A rich man deprived of his fair share, only to be lost to graft, fraud, corruption, to the benefit of no one. The exact opposite of Christian charity. We would never tolerate Christians, our own children, denying the faith and the word of God, the sacraments and the gathering of the faithful, wandering off into myths, finding their bliss outside of the house of God. Because we're righteous people. We would never do those things. That's a warning to us too. That in this unrighteousness and in this hatred of the Lord and his gifts, there is danger of us being set ablaze. By the way, being set ablaze in the scriptures is not a good thing. Being set ablaze in the scriptures is what happens to the wicked ones that are burnt root and branch, or nothing but stubble remains. And Malachi continues. But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings. You shall go out leaping like calves from the stall. You shall tread down the wicked, for they will become ashes under the soles of your feet. On the day when I act, says the Lord of hosts. This is why we cry, repent us, O Lord, because he does this. He turns us from sin and every evil. He turns our hearts to trust in him and him alone. This is where our friends, the intellectual descendants of the Anabaptists, struggle, those seeing our work as a thing that precedes baptism, our believing that makes us worthy of baptism. And seeing our own work everywhere else in the Christian faith, too. This is not so. In the words of baptism, in the water and work of baptism, where God does his thing, there is contained the gift of repentance also. It's the work of God in and upon us, the healing wings of the very Son of God. He brings forgiveness and salvation to you. Babies, accountable adolescents, whatever that means, adults, even those who are near death, the healing aqueous wings of the Son of God is for you. It's his work saving you from your sin and bringing repentance to you to turn you from sin perpetually forevermore. The prophet continues, remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and the just decrees that I commanded him at Horeb before all Israel. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction. Moreover, the Lord sends us his word. He sends us his messengers, the men who we call pastors, to come and preach among us, constantly preaching repentance and forgiveness again and again and again, always returning to him, always turning our hearts back to the love of the Lord, back to the covenant the Lord has with us, the one in which he is faithful, the one in which we are unfaithful. The day of the Lord is coming, dear Christians, but fear not. He is restoring you toward salvation. Hear again the words of the psalmist. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. Repent us, O God. Don't ablaze us. Quench us in your forgiveness instead. In fact, that word, that shining face language, ought to sound like the Aaronic benediction that we hear at the close of every service. The Lord make his face shine upon you, giving you his forgiving peace, that you may dwell in that peace and return to the house of the Lord again in repentance, trusting that forgiveness and peace are yours right here in the house of the Lord. In the name of this Jesus, amen.